name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Make haste, O God, to deliver me. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit.
O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto thee all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended thee, and justly deserve thy temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray thee of thy boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of thy beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord, Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea.
Kyrie, God Father in heaven above, great art thou in grace and love. Of all things the Maker and Redeemer, eleison, eleison. Kyrie, O Christ our King, salvation for sinners thou didst bring. O Lord Jesus, God's own Son, our Mediator at the heavenly throne, hear our cry and grant our supplication. Eleison, eleison. Kyrie, O God the Holy Ghost, God our faith, the gift we need the most. Do thou our last hour bless. Let us leave this sinful world with gladness. Eleison, eleison. Amen.
To us no harm shall now come nigh, the strife at last is ended. God showeth his good will to men, and peace shall reign on earth again. Oh, thank him for his good.
Amen.
beseech thee, thy Holy Spirit upon thy faithful people, keep them steadfast in thy grace and truth, protect and comfort them in all temptations, defend them against all enemies of thy word, and bestow upon Christ Church militant thy saving peace, through the same Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. Amen. O God, who causes wars to cease to the ends of the earth, forgive us our godlessness and hatred. Hear our prayers on behalf of all who suffer at the hands of aggressors, and grant an end to strife, so that thy people may worship thee in peace, and call others to Christ in freedom, through the same Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. Amen.
The Old Testament lesson appointed for reading on Reformation Sunday is recorded for us in the Record of Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, chapter 29, verses 12 through 19. In the days of Hezekiah the king, and at his command, these Levites arose: Mahath the son of Amasai, and Joel the son of Azariah, of the sons of the Korathites. Of the sons of Merari, Kish the son of Abdi, and Azariah the son of Jehalel. Of the Gershonites, Joah the son of Zimmah, and Eden the son of Joah. Of the sons of Elizaphan, Shimri and Jeiel. Of the sons of Asaphah, Zechariah and Mattaniah. Of the sons of Haman, Jehiel and Shimei. And the sons of Jeduthun, Shemaiah and Uziel. And they gathered their brethren, sanctified themselves, and went according to the command of the king at the words of the Lord to cleanse the house of the Lord. Then the priests went into the inner part of the house of the Lord to cleanse it, and brought out all the debris that they found in the temple of the Lord to the court of the house of the Lord. And the Levites took it out and carried it to the brook Kidron. Now they began to sanctify on the first day of the first month, and on the eighth day of the month they came to the vestibule of the Lord. So they sanctified the house of the Lord in 8 days, and on the 16th day of the first month they finished. Then they went in to King Hezekiah and said, "We have cleansed all the house of the Lord, the altar of burnt offerings with all its articles, and the table of the showbread with all its articles. Moreover, all the articles which King Ahaz in his reign had cast aside in his transgression, we have prepared and sanctified, and there they are, before the altar of the Lord." Here ends the Old Testament lesson.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Walk about Zion, tell the towers thereof, mark well her bulwarks and consider her palaces, that ye may tell it to the generation following. Hallelujah, hallelujah, for this God is our God forever and ever. He will be our guide even unto death. Hallelujah.
The Holy Epistle, or second reading for today, is recorded for us in the Revelation of Jesus Christ to St. John, beginning in chapter 14, verse 6, and reading through verse 7. St. John recorded for us, "I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, "Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea, and the springs of water." Here ends the lesson. Please arise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel for this day is recorded for us in the Gospel according to St. Matthew, beginning in chapter 11 at the 12th verse. Jesus spoke to the multitude, saying, "From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, and if you are willing to receive it, he is Elijah who is to come. He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Here ends the Holy Gospel.
Father, who to us in love hath the right time.
words on which we meditate this morning are the words of the gospel lesson that you have just heard. Let us pray.
Heavenly Father, make us holy in the truth. Your word is true. Amen.
Please be seated. Dear fellow redeemed, all flesh is grass, and all its loveliness is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, because the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass, the grass withers, the flower fades. But the word of our God stands forever. Amen. That may seem like a bit of an odd greeting and maybe a little bit depressing, but we live on the promises of God. The promises of God remain forever. Our world changes rapidly. Things come and go. Our parents abandon us. We even confess in the prophecies of the Old Testament. And yet when mother and father abandon us, not because they want to, but because they too must go the way of all flesh, yet the word of the Lord remains forever. It stands firm. The promises of God in our Savior Jesus Christ remain. And so we consider our gospel lesson this morning, where Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force." And we consider that that is, in fact, one of those delightful double entendres in the scriptures. Because it can be translated just as legitimately, the kingdom of heaven experiences enthusiasm, not in the historical theological sense, we'll talk about that in a moment. And the enthusiastic press their way, or it experiences zeal, and the zealous force their way into the kingdom of heaven. And in the context of Jesus' words, talking about John the Baptist, pretty difficult to choose one translation over the other. And with the number of double entendres that we see in the scriptures, I think we do well to recognize that the Holy Spirit intends those double meanings, intends for us to contemplate the various ways of understanding those words, not choosing one over the other, but embracing both and learning from both. So it is, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence. In Jesus' day, there were those who would stamp out the kingdom of heaven. Certainly, during the times of the Old Testament, there were armies that came that wanted to get rid of the temple in Jerusalem and indeed destroyed it. And the Roman army again would destroy the temple in Jerusalem in 70 AD, not all that long after Jesus ascended into heaven. There is violence done to the Church of God to this day. And while it's disturbing that the United States is drawn into a conflict in the Middle East where Muslims attack Jews and Jews respond in kind, without much fanfare, the Holy Christian Church suffers violence as the bullets go through the windows from both directions, and our brothers and sisters in Christ quietly endure as the armies go back and forth over their homes where they live and where their parents and ancestors have lived for thousands of years, hundreds for sure, and more than 1,000 years. So, what do we do with all of this violence toward the kingdom of heaven? We pray. We pray for peace. And you notice that in our prayers, whether it be the collect for today that specifically talked in regard to peace and freedom, or it be in the general prayer that we pray most Sundays, we don't name the enemy by name and pick a side. we don't look at Hamas and Israel and say one is right and holy and the other is unrighteous and wrong and need to be destroyed. We are human beings. We don't claim to know the ins and outs of all of these things that are going on. We simply pray that God, for the sake of His church, would grant peace and be with the people who are suffering aggression, no matter where the aggression comes from. That God would grant peace and freedom so that His people may worship Him in peace and call others to Christ in freedom. Certainly, in this conflict in the Middle East, neither side is righteous in the eyes of God. They are in open rebellion against their God, against their Savior. There is no other God, no other Savior. They need to repent of their rebellion against Jesus Christ and know the salvation that is in Him and experience what peace, real peace with God, is like. And from there, work in love toward the people around them so that everyone might be able to live in this world and not fear their life being ended in a moment because of hatred. Hatred first and foremost against Jesus Christ, who came in peace to suffer and die at our hands, not lashing out in hatred or revenge, but seeking peace with God the Father for us and calling us to endure much wrongdoing in this life so that we can show others there is a better way. There is a way of peace. Yes, the kingdom of heaven in this world suffers violence from unbelievers on the outside. It does. And it happens in our day, and it appears to be increasing in our country. We don't know exactly how things will go, but it seems that way. But the kingdom of heaven suffers violence internally as well. And the hymn that we sang a few weeks ago that I said is very much more the ballad of the Reformation, at least it certainly was at the time. It cries out in this uneasy longing for God to help His people, talking about how the teachers in the church lead the people to and fro in error's ways astounded. And they arrogantly speak, "Now where is He who will forbid our speech? We own no Lord and Master." And in the church to this day, there are those who arrogantly speak falsehood, and they defy God to stop them. Some of them live in shocking luxury and wealth while they tell people who are dying or starving or homeless that if they would just send more money to them, the false preacher, that they too could live in wealth and have a life of ease in this world. It's false teaching. That's not what the Christian faith is about. Jesus said, "If you are my disciples, you will suffer in this world like I suffer." St. Paul raised a very low bar for what we should expect in this world. He said, "Having food and clothing, we will be content with these." That's a pretty low bar. Okay? Those who come to you and say, "If you just send me some money, or if you really believe, then everything is going to go okay in your life in this world." No, it's not. If you claim citizenship in heaven, you are a foreigner in this world, and the world considers you its enemy. You gather here in the local embassy of the Kingdom of Heaven to be encouraged and strengthened and have a moment's peace before you go back out there as citizens of heaven to make a difference in the world, sort of like heaven's little Peace Corps, where you remain in this world for a time, even though you're a citizen of heaven, to bring something better to this world, to actively work for the good of this world, that this world might know Jesus. And so we show concern for the people around us. And throughout history, Christians have done incredible works of charity at their own expense, building hospitals and staffing them, learning medicine so that they can help the sick and the dying, not to preserve life in this world, but through mercy that people may come to know Jesus, who brings eternal healing and eternal life. But there is violence that the church suffers internally from the false teachers who tear it apart and tear it down and take the beauty of forgiveness in Christ and change it in a way to manipulate people. It's violence, and it's done by people who do violence to God's word. Yes, truly, the Kingdom of Heaven suffers violence. And we celebrate Reformation because God arose in that day some 500 years ago, and through his chosen servant, Martin Luther, and many others, he held firm to his gospel and his sacraments for the sake of his people. Where the gospel was turned into another law of do and do, rule upon rule, work upon work by man, God, through Martin Luther and others, kept it pure for you and for me down to our own day. That the gospel of Jesus Christ is this: Christ has come as the new man, the new Adam, to be righteous before God in our place and to suffer and die for your sin and my sin, so that we have peace with God. And he rose from the dead because the grave cannot hold human beings anymore, because sin has been paid for. And every person will ultimately rise from the dead, cured of all disease. And what a tragedy for anyone who persists in the rebellion, saying, I do not want God and his ways. I will be one of the violent ones who either attacks the church physically or corrupts the teaching from the inside out. How sad for those people in that day, because their sin paid for by Christ, and having risen from the dead, because sin has been paid for and the grave cannot claim us permanently anymore, yet they will suffer in the worst grave, separation from God in hell forever. Why? Because they didn't want this God-man Savior Jesus Christ. They wanted to do it their way. And their way will separate them from God forever. That brings us to that other way of understanding the passage for today. Even where at times you and I have been rebellious and harbor some rebellion, probably even at the moment, toward God in one way or another, and would like to corrupt his teaching to say what we want it to say, yet God, by the Holy Spirit, has shown us how desperate the situation is, that there is only one way to any sort of happiness in eternity, indeed any real happiness even now, and that is through that eternal promise of God, that if we will turn from our sin, call it what it is, sin, that which is displeasing to God and that which separates us from God, and if we would embrace the only Savior, that one that God himself sent to us, the God himself who became a human being for us,
then there is forgiveness, life, and salvation for us. And while the Lord's Supper was turned into a work of human beings to benefit those who might not even be here to partake of it, God, roughly 500 years ago, through Martin Luther and others, restored and preserved that sacrament for what it really is: God's work among us, where our Savior gives to us his holy body and his precious blood for the forgiveness of our sins, to renew us from the inside out. And so we become enthusiastic, not enthusiasts who believe God is talking directly to them apart from the scriptures and the sacraments, not that kind of enthusiast, who are full of a buzzing inside of themselves and go every which way the wind blows and then some, but enthusiasts in the sense that we, having been filled with the Holy Spirit, see how valuable a gift God has given us in his word and in his sacraments, the pledge of forgiveness and eternal life, peace with himself and salvation. And being enthused by that, being zealous and eager because of that, we force our way into the kingdom of heaven, saying, God, you sent your son to die for me. I belong to you. Do not reject me. It reminds us of that woman who kept crying out after Jesus, you gotta help me. I have nothing and no one else. Help me. And Jesus said, why should I give the children's food to the dogs? Lord, even the dogs eat from the crumbs that fall from the master's table. You are my master. If I am a dog to you, I'm a dog, but I still expect to be fed by you. Oh, what zeal, what determination, that will not hear anything from God other than the promise, I love you in my son. I forgive you all of your sins, because my son paid for your sin when he died on the cross. I wrap my arms around you as my child, and I give you eternal life because my son claims you as his sibling, his brother, and his sister. And I do not view you as a dog, but as a prince or a princess, a member of my royal family. And you will be with me. You will feast on your Savior's body and blood today in the here and now. And you will feast on him through all of eternity, when you are finally free of every tear, every sorrow, every conflict within yourself that wants to draw you away from God because you really want this, you really love this, but it's evil in God's sight. You will be free of those temptations, and you will finally, completely, and purely love the things that God counts as good and right. Yes, all flesh is as grass, but the word of the Lord endures forever, and his word declares you holy. His word declares you alive in Christ now and forever. The word of the Lord endures forever. And the zealous ones eagerly press into the kingdom of heaven, and are joyfully received. Amen. Please arise. And now the peace of God, which goes beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
O eternal and most merciful God, we bless and praise thee for all thy benefits, and especially for those mercies which we commemorate this day. Praise be to thee that thou didst send forth thine only begotten Son into the world to be the propitiation for our sins, and didst institute the ministry of the word to make known thy saving health among all nations. Praise be to thee especially this day that, when the gross darkness of popery covered the earth, thou didst kindle afresh the light of thy holy word, and through thy chosen vessel, Martin Luther, didst teach our fathers once more the everlasting gospel of salvation. Praise be to thee that thou hast to this day preserved the goodly heritage, saved us from persecution and confusing creeds, defended churches and schools from the assaults of Satan, given strength and success to thy word, and at all times provided faithful shepherds to feed thy flock in the pleasant pastures of thy word. We acknowledge and confess in sincere repentance that by our manifold sins, ingratitude, indifference, and unbelief, we have indeed deserved that thou mightest justly hide thy face from us and visit us with a famine of thy word. But we beseech thee, O Lord, deal with us not after our sins, but according to thine infinite compassion. Let not the gates of hell prevail against thy church. Preserve us from human traditions and doctrines of men, from strong delusions to subvert the foundation of truth and to mislead men upon false ways. Grant unto us peace and good government, and let truth, justice, and liberty dwell in our land and throughout the world, that without restraint or hindrance, we may continually enjoy the blessing of thy pure word. Preserve unto us and our children the pure and saving gospel and the right use of the holy sacraments till the end of our days. Send us to this end at all times blameless teachers, able ministers of the New Testament, faithful stewards of thy mysteries, and give them wisdom and boldness to proclaim thy salvation to many unto life. Let us not misuse the gospel unto false peace in a dead faith, but kept by the light of truth, let us walk as the children of light. Let us be a city that is set on a hill to shine afar unto the day of Christ's coming. Give us increase of faith and of numbers. Restore all that are deceived by error, and give free course and strength to thy word, that it may become known among all the nations of the earth. Do good in thy good pleasure to Zion. Build thou the walls of Jerusalem. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would look in mercy upon those who are sick or suffering in any way. We pray for our neighbor across the street, that you would grant her health and healing insofar as you are willing, but in all things that you would continue to bless her with sincere faith unto eternal life. We pray also for the neighborhood, that you would help them to guard against thieves that come in the night, and that safety and peace might govern their neighborhood. We pray that you would bless your servants, Jeremy, Nathan, and Joel, in the death of their father, and grant them hope and peace in the gospel of Jesus Christ and comfort in your holy word. We pray that you would continue to bless Matthew Payne as he recovers from his surgery. We thank you for safe and successful surgery and pray that he would continue to have health and healing. We also pray that you would bless Yulia in her travels, grant her success to her efforts to help those in the midst of war, and that you would return her safely home once again. Gird us all with thy power, that we may fight a good fight and keep the faith until we shall obtain the crown of righteousness laid up for us in heaven, for thy Son, our dear Savior's sake, who lives and reigns with thee and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. Amen.
Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace.
Glory to his merit, O triune God in heaven.